leading a esteemed panel this morning of venture investors, leading investors in a variety of technologies and capabilities. I'm Brian Schettler. I lead the venture capital arm of Boeing, which we established about 3 years ago. Made a number of investments in key enabling technologies for the future of aerospace, Spark Cognition being one of them. But I'd like my panelists here to introduce themselves a little bit and talk about their firms, and then we'll get into some more specific questions. So, Bilal.
Bilal Zuberi, I'm a partner at a firm, Lux Capital. I'm based in Menlo Park. We have offices in Menlo Park and in New York City. We manage about $2.5 billion investing in early stage companies. We like to think we invest in science fiction becoming science fact. So craziest ideas are not crazy enough for us. You know, satellite companies, drone companies, robotics, autonomous vehicles. At the end of the day, the idea is to move human life forward, to imagine new futures. And I think who we back are these passionate entrepreneurs who are imagining a world different than we live in. Sometimes they're crazy and are proven to be crazy. And sometimes they do amazing things and it changes our world.
Thanks. I'm Rumi Morales. As mentioned, I'm a partner and head of venture at Outlier Ventures, which is based in Chicago with me, but also in London and Toronto and Berlin. And we're really focusing on the clear fact, it's easy to say, but it's harder to execute in practice, that no technology exists in isolation. And even though that we're here kind of focusing in AI, we have to look at advancements in robotics and Internet of Things together with blockchain and think about how are these technologies going to be working together. And so at Outlier, we are very early stage, not just investors, but active developers. You can think of us almost as a merchant banking and advisory services firm, as we're taking a number of these technology infrastructure protocols and trying to make them something for the future. Particularly, and you asked, Brian, what gets me excited, we're focusing a lot on machine-to-machine communications than transactions. If you think about the trillions of devices now coming online and the future of how they're going to have to interact with each other is not just about one technology in and of itself, but the interaction of several. So that's what we do at Outlier.
I'm Sumant. I'm a partner at March Capital. March is a relatively young fund. We're about 5 years old. We have about $1 billion or so under management. We are proud investors in Spark Cognition very recently. So this is my first time at this conference. It's quite larger than I expected it to be. Austin's much colder than I expected it to be. We're headquartered in Santa Monica in Los Angeles. It's nice and warm there today, 85. The beach is nice. So I'm going to suggest to Amini thinks about where this where he hosts this next time. We're a little bit stage agnostic. We focus on enterprise technologies, industrial technologies. We have investments in cybersecurity. We have Series A investments, very early stage companies that are trying to change the world. We have companies that are generating hundreds of millions of dollars of revenue in our portfolio. What we look for is investments at companies at inflection points. And I'd say the last 5 years or so, AI is kind of a buzzword that's becoming more and more mainstream. So it kind of applies to each and every one of the companies we look at or invest in. You're sort of saying I'm an internet company, or I'm a mobile company, or I'm a cloud company. Now everyone's an AI company. And so, you know, life keeps going on. Someday it's going to be 5G companies, and we kind of look for those inflections and fundamental technology shifts, and our investments sort of take shape around those.
Well, let's get started with some direct questions. This first one, pretty broad and generic, but helpful, I think, for all of us to opine on and have a conversation around. But what are you all seeing as sort of the current state of AI investing? You know, it's seen some growth. $9 billion, I think, is some of the latest stats on sort of annual venture investment going into AI. But it also gets a lot of publicity for being high on the hype curves. And you know, is it really making an impact? And how is adoption going? But what are the trends you all are seeing? How are your firms sort of attacking the opportunities? Or are some starting to back away and there's more opportunity? How are you just seeing it all playing out?
AI is so broad. AI is an extension of machine learning, which was an extension of big data, and I think these were all buzzwords that have been used over the last 10 years. But it affects every single industry. I think John earlier was absolutely right. This is the thing that's going to impact almost every industry over the next 10 years. And I think we're seeing that in very different ways. Not only are we seeing investments being made at the infrastructure layer, so really when you're doing AI at scale, what is the infrastructure that's really needed? What kind of compute? Everything from down to the chip, you know, bare metal, up to the application layer. I think people are making investments to be able to do that at scale. we've made numerous investments. We have a company based here, actually Mythic, which is doing chip computing, AI computing at the edge, and providing semiconductors for that. But then you have companies that are autonomous car companies that are building bottoms up, full stack autonomous vehicle, and it would not be possible without without AI. And then you, if you start to think about AI being used in every aspect of our life, you know, if our loan and insurance decisions are getting made by AI, if our credit card, credit limits are being determined by AI, then you really have to start thinking about the ethics, the transparency, the explainability. So there's emerging fields of explainability AI where we've invested in companies like Fiddler and so on. And then if AI is actually driving important conversations, when you're talking about, you know, many of you may have noticed on Facebook, there's this thing button you can press on ad and you can see, why am I seeing that ad? Now, they don't really tell you exactly why. They just kind of give you some BS. But the reality is that they do know why you're getting that ad. And I think businesses are making important decisions. So I'm not sure of any investment firm backing away from AI, but maybe some are. A little bit of hype is always necessary for any new field to emerge and be pushed, and you have evangelists who actually push the frontiers of that, and sometimes they sort of warp the ecosystem around them to actually pull people in. That said, we have to be a little bit careful that, number one, we don't scare people. Right? I mean, there are people who believe AI is going to, you know, build these humanoids that'll come start shooting and then we don't know what to do. I mean, let's be a little bit careful about realistic of what is really possible. These things are very early, and some of these will take 10, 20, 30 years to become real.
The definition of AI is broadened considerably. So if you look at that dollar figure and then you actually look at the companies calling themselves AI, you really, I think, would do you well to actually analyze their technology and say, is this just advanced data, big data, or is this really something transformational and different? So actually, I would question how much dollars are going into very advanced, emerging data technologies, partly because I think, as well, a lot of the transformational bets do not happen during times of good economic growth. And I've seen this in terms of a number of potential customers that are adopting AI solutions. These are not like the massive things that can change companies, but just, oh, maybe we will automate this here, or we'll put a bot there and lower costs just a little bit. I think for me, what I would really like to see would be people taking larger bets, right, on larger transformations as we think about what the potential impact of artificial intelligence can be on future industries. But for the time being, I feel like we're still in a stage of incremental growth.
I don't know what's left to add, but for us, it's really looking at businesses that are using technology to create efficiency for their customers. AI is one piece of that. And I think what we've learned yesterday, if you were watching some of the panels and if you'd go talk to customers in the enterprise space, people don't adopt technology, cutting-edge technology, quickly. It takes time for them to get used to something. So I think really looking at the application and looking at what your customers' needs are is important, rather than get too sort of dogmatic about what technology and what kind of AI and how deep is your knowledge and this and that. Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's the customer needs a product, and you can serve it to them, make money. That's good business. Now, there's a lot of people have adopted technologies over the last few decades and have created a lot of efficiency, but there's still a lot of inefficiency in business in general. If you look at just the call center industry, it's $350 billion of spend a year. $200 billion of that goes into human capital. And I don't know anyone who calls a call center isn't happy with the service. So there's obviously some mismatch here between the technical frameworks there and the people's training and how people answer questions. And I think AI-driven technologies is a great sort of solution to help go solve something like that. But it doesn't work for everything. I agree that RPA is sort of, you know, where all the energy and attention is. This is robotic process automation, but not necessarily deep technology and may not last. But this is a good step in the evolution of how large enterprises will adopt these technologies. So it's sort of I think anything and everything is an evolution, and you have to see where you are in it and then look at your investments accordingly.
Great, thanks for that. So all of us have made investments in AI early stage companies. What were some of the qualities, right? There's a lot of companies out there, a lot of choices. What were some of the qualities that made it attractive for you, how it fit your investment thesis? And then, you know, really what are some of the qualities of them that you think will make them successful in the long run?
We are the type that we're called outlier for a reason. I think we're going out there always trying to hit a home run 20 years from now. So we are focused less, I suppose, on customer adoption, more what kind of radical transformations can we take place. So, for example, one investment in the AI space that we made is in a company called Fetch.ai. They're coming out of Cambridge University. This is actually the former DeepMind people. After Google bought DeepMind, they thought to themselves, well, wait a minute, why does Google get that? Why can't we just share this with everyone? So they combine the notion of the distributed ledger, which is the overall technology construct that is reflected in things perhaps like the Bitcoin blockchain, and saying, okay, so you put a data on a ledger. So what? It's just sitting there. How do those data points on that ledger learn from each other, right? How can those actually be able to utilize things that people are putting on a blockchain and learn from them and act upon them? So for us at Outlier, we have that specific thesis where we're trying to combine things like blockchain and ledgers with AI. So it can seem a little bit fanciful, but I do think in the future, as we're thinking about a universe where increasingly we're going to depend on robots or other types of autonomous agents to help us make decisions based on the access of data that they can access versus that we can, this can be a potential solution to make that easier and more effective.
You know, I've been doing this almost 20 years now, and I don't think too many things have changed over the years. And when we look at things that work and things that haven't as investments, and it really starts with the people that you're investing in. And for me, that's, if you say, what do you look at in something and when you, before you invest in, is what's the team, who are the people you're investing behind? Very important. How big is the market? What's the pain point? All of those things, if you have good people, they know what to focus on, how to create value. So, you know, in the case of Spark, and Amir is an interesting person we've known for many years, and we've been watching the company, and they finally have something that I think in the last few years, large industrial companies, other enterprises have started by, and becomes an interesting investment choice for us. And so, I think it's people-centric, less technology-centric, at least for us. It's market-centric, looking at sort of what's the pain point, what ability does this company have to go solve that for their customers. And that's not changed over the last 20 years. I think that'll continue to be the sort of investing theme for us.
Right. What do you all think about sort of the enabling infrastructure, too, around AI? You know, big demands on high bandwidth, low latency networks, connectivity. Are you guys placing bets and investments in there as sort of enabler? How are you seeing the whole infrastructure piece around AI coming together and the venture piece of it?
We've invested in semiconductor technologies. We've invested in bandwidth latency issues, especially as you think about gaming. You know, there's parts of the world. If you're living in New York City and you're living in California somewhere, you have really high bandwidth and your Zoom calls are perfect and you're like, great, right? But if you're in rural North Dakota and you're trying to get on a Zoom call with your teammates, you might actually see a lot of latency. Now imagine you playing Riot games that are real-time games that you're, you know, or Epic's games, and you're sitting in like Saudi Arabia. The kind of latency issues are unbelievable, because you don't even have access to the proprietary networks that have been created by, the major Skypes and Googles of the world. So absolutely, we've invested there. There's a lot of new technologies that are coming out that were developed for large data aggregation and holding at large companies. So Uber's M3 projects or Amazon's projects. And these were all technologies that were built internally to manage very large data sets. And to process those, and now becoming open source and becoming available, and people are building companies around it to make it accessible to other companies who have invested in some of those. Many of them are still in stealth. There are, from computer vision to NLP, there's very interesting technologies around data transferability and, you know, how do you have these open source models get implemented at scale? Nobody builds models anymore. These are all open source. People are really training these models and adapting them. How do you do that? And then, as I mentioned, of course, there's application layer. There are companies like Primer and Orbital Insight that are extracting insights for particular industries. And last but not the least, if you have AI, as I said, across all industries, you really have to start thinking about ethics, transparency, compliance, and companies like Fiddler Labs come to mind. There's actually a local company called Yonder, which used to be called New Knowledge, which is really around understanding what is authentic internet. We assumed for a while that internet is a democratizing force and everything is authentic because my voice is authentic. Well, it turns out my voice is drowned if there's 10,000 bots that are tweeting about something, then it doesn't really matter what you and I have to say. So how do you actually have an authentic conversation? And so before you become a consumer conversation, it's also how do brands have a conversation? How do the brands listen to what is the community really saying about my brand versus BS that's being posted by bots or a coordinated campaign? And similarly, how do I communicate with those brands? And understanding that requires, you know, massive manipulation of data and understanding, you know, how these models evolve.
I mean, I'll add to that. I think people kind of don't quite appreciate that the infrastructure that, you know, we take for granted here doesn't exist in most parts of the world. And that, you know, even in large enterprises, if you look at how they have adopted cloud, I think cloud workloads, enterprise workloads, less than 20% of enterprise workloads are on the cloud today. So there's a lot of work required just to capture the efficiency that these new technologies are providing. And I'd say 80% of that hasn't been done yet. So AI is an interesting new phenomenon, let's say last 5 to 7 years, where the workloads and the computation power has sort of pushed everything to the limit because you have so much data that you have to work with. So there's a lot of work going around there, and we have investments in things like edge computing or data transfer, secure data transfer, cloud, centralized cloud management of these end devices because the number of devices is exploding. So yes, we do look at that, but at the end of the day, where we sit in the investing value chain, which is probably a little different from yours and maybe some overlap with where Bilal is, you know, you have to look at the business possibility of what you're trying to build and invest where you see an inflection point where you think the company's going to do better than the rest of the market thinks. And that's how you make money for your investors. So yes, we invest across the different value chain and technology stack and look to find, you know, good opportunities to invest in all of these.
When it comes to infrastructure, another way, the way I look at it to make sure that we have successful outcomes with AI is investment in policy and working with regulators. I look in particular across at other countries in China specifically, and looking at, as a result, also in the United States, you know, what can be done? What must we do in order for us to be able to make sure that AI is implemented morally, ethically, and fairly. And a large part of that begins with education. So, you know, I'm part of a number of civic organizations. Most of them are something called the Chamber of Digital Commerce, which educates people on Capitol Hill about advanced technology. And going as far as getting more involved in presidential campaigns on technology policy, because we need to be talking about this as a society. I'm a little bit grateful. I don't know if anyone caught the last Democratic debate, but there was a good chunk of time spent on automation, which is the first time I've ever heard in any presidential people really talking about where this could possibly lead. But I do not think that it should be dismissed. I do not think it should be seen as a threat. We need to be seeing this as an opportunity. But as a result, for any venture investor, I think focusing on AI as an investment, you also have to be socially invested in the impacts that it can have, and then be politically engaged to make sure that the outcomes are successful.
Continuing on the sort of policy theme a little bit and how trade policy or national security policy things are playing out as it relates to AI, how are you all seeing that impacting AI companies' ability to attract funding, maybe non-US funding, specifically even maybe China funding? You know, the rising importance of CFIUS and other government bodies that are more scrutinizing, you know, foreign investments in, you know, kind of key technologies in the U.S. Are you guys seeing any of that impacting the startups you've invested in now, or when you're approaching new ones, you know, adding complications to the fundraising picture?
Somewhat. I'd say the system and how it's being implemented today has probably the right initiatives applied wrongly or executed wrongly. It's kind of slow and bureaucratic, and anything that does that slows us down if we run into that. So, you know, a bunch of our companies raising money from outside have to get CFIUS clearance. It just can take you 3 to 6 months before you see the end of that tunnel. We've tried to sell companies in the past where the buyer has been a foreign buyer and that's been stuck in CFIUS. It delayed the closing by 6 to 9 months. And so you do see that. I will say, though, there's enough capital available for good companies. There's never been more capital available for good companies. And if you have a company that's doing well or it has an interesting idea and a good team, capital is a commodity now. You have to really look for someone you can partner with to build a company. So it's two sides of sort of saying, you know, it's constraining in some individual sort of, I would say, examples, but the market as a whole doesn't seem to have really, it hasn't seemed to have impacted anything.
my side where people are seeking alternative financing besides equity. So whether you're issuing a token, for example, on a cryptocurrency exchange, we take a number of our protocols to China. The regulatory, ironically, you would think that the government clamps down there a little bit harder in certain areas, but when it comes to advanced technologies, there's a much more concerted effort by the government to be very supportive, not just of technologies themselves, but different ways of promoting their growth. So that's something that kind of worries me, because on the flip side, if anyone caught some of the hearings with Facebook over Libra, their cryptocurrency, versus what's happening with the embrace right now by Xi Jinping of blockchain and crypto in China. Again, at Outlier, we don't see this as isolated, but take that, take the fact that China will be issuing its own cryptocurrency together with everything that we know that they're working on with data and AI, right? Together with the fact that as their society is structured, people feel like their data as a community will be shared and they understand that. I think about all of this when it comes to our future competitiveness. But dialing this all back, our portfolio companies are seeking money in China because they're a little bit more accommodating with new ways of thinking about financing innovation.
There are both privacy and national security considerations that I don't think are being explained well and being understood well. I was at a board meeting where we're literally having a conversation that, hey, over the last 3 months, this tariff business has changed so much that actually if we put this chip versus that chip, our tariffs go from 10% to 15%. Actually, if put a screen on it, then it gets qualified as a phone, which is not a phone, but then our tariffs go from 30% to 10%. So maybe we should put a screen on it, even though we don't need it, because we just get 20% discount on the tariff. I mean, this is stupidity happening at companies real time right now to be able to manage a very dynamic environment, and it's unclear in 6 months if we'll have any tariffs at all. And people are making hardware decisions today around what to do to be able to do business with China. I mean, we don't have a supply chain here. We cannot build products here even if we wanted to, let alone a startup that's trying to compete with large incumbents internationally. But the second thing is technology. I mean, you know, this idea of this geeky guys eating pizza and writing code and getting away with whatever doesn't really work anymore. It doesn't really work anymore if your products are changing governments around the world or causing anxiety among civilians and citizens in the US. So you have to step out and take a leadership role. And again, in one of those situations where, you know, our assumptions of the past don't really carry out into the future, and if there is a distrust already with the people involved or the institutions involved, and they start to use AI and automation in other ways, that distrust can only get amplified. So I think there's a very sharp need that's going to, you know, become very obvious over the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years of a real civil conversation that we need to have as a country, both about our own internal organizations and institutions and how we manage them and how we, you know, oversee them and so on. And then also our relationship to the rest of the world.
Anything that you'd say kind of keeps you up at night? Challenges that AI might face in the future, whether it's around your investments or the technology in general, but just to kind of leave the audience with here, just any kind of worry beads or things to think about?
Immigration. It really worries me. Amir is an immigrant. I'm an immigrant. Many of you sitting in this audience that, again, I can't see, but many of you are immigrants. I've had multiple companies that have been unable to get the visas required, even if they were in the U.S., to transfer from one company to another, because you're explaining to somebody who barely has high school education that this AI is actually the same as that AI. You know, this is a real problem. And if we lose the talent, you know, if those of you who read published papers, I mean, you can see how many of those authors have foreign-sounding names, right? And if you want that talent in this country, we have to figure out how to solve that problem. We have to bring them in. I suggest anybody who gets an advanced degree in any of these advanced sciences, whether it's physics, chemistry, math, AI, computer science, whatever, the first thing we should do is staple a visa with it and say you're a, you know, naturalized citizen here or you're a resident here. And the reason is because if you don't do that, then they always have one leg outside the country. They're always trying to figure out what will they do if you kick them out, which means that they're always ready to work with another government or another entity, which means that they're potential targets by other countries. So we really have to work on that, and that's an important thing to me.
For me, that this, the social ramifications of what this technology and related technologies will do for our industries and our economies. And I know a lot of people say, oh, you know, industrial revolution, people found other jobs, or people find other jobs. Okay, I know we'll find other jobs, but that transition can be very difficult. and increasingly with the speed of technology innovation, also very scary and very isolating. So I don't know like the best ways as an investor where to put my money in those areas, but I know where I can put my time. And I think, again, I would encourage all of you to become very engaged, whether it's educational efforts, civic efforts, or political efforts, if you care about AI, that you care about engaging your fellow people and human beings to advocate for the opportunities that it presents.
Actually, I'll end by saying one thing. What we do is actually a lot of fun, because we work with really creative people. We meet new creative ideas every day. So, you know, going to bed at night worrying about something happens, but not as often as one would imagine. I think policy in general, and where the world is, and macroeconomic conditions and geopolitical conditions in the world have a very direct effect on what we do as our companies mature. And financial market health, you know, we didn't touch on it, but sort of the rise of the Vision Fund and things like that, and hundreds of billions of dollars of money flowing into our markets that's sort of undisciplined, very undisciplined, as we're finding out now. Those things do worry us because they affect us in our investment decision-making, and they affect the potential returns that we were hoping to get. So I'd say that's the bigger issue that we think about all the time. Other than that, it's a lot of fun. It's a great time to be an investor in this space. And, you know, all our companies seem to be doing well enough, and we'll see how it shapes up in the next 5 to 10 years.
Well, please join me in thanking our three panelists for an excellent discussion today. Bilal, Rumi, Sumant, thanks so much for your time and insights.